you here to the First Congregational Church of Sunderland. This is a congregation of the United Church of Christ, which is a nationwide organization. We welcome members, we welcome friends and family, guests, and also seekers. We welcome believers who are solid in their faith, and I hope there's a bunch of us here who are like that. But we also welcome searchers, people who are looking for Jesus, people who are looking for the Spirit, something spiritual in their lives that maybe they don't know exactly what it is, but they're seeking. And as soon as they're seeking, that's a step towards faith. We welcome them. So as we try to say in one way or another, and with all of that said, you are welcome here, whoever you are, whatever you're looking for, however you express your faith in God, you are welcome here at Sunderland Congregational Church. So with all of that said, let us now turn to our opening hymn and the candle lighting, blue hymnal number 457. Lord, I want to be a Christian.
Praise be to God. Amen.
And now in our unison prayer, let's reach out to those who are maybe watching on Zoom, maybe those who will join us via FCAT. Let us all come together in this larger congregation of God's people as we share the unison prayer. You watch over us, O Lord, and show us the way to a better life, not so much filled with things as the relationships that contribute to our wholeness and holiness. Thank you for leading us here and helping us to deal with worldly distractions and conflicts. We submit ourselves to you for instruction. Help us to be honest with ourselves and before you, voicing our doubts as well as our faith, creating us a space for quiet listening and thoughtful meditation. Inspire us to see greatness not in status over others, but as the power to follow you closely and help you build a better world for all. Amen. Let's now share singing of the Gloria Patri.
Has a little inscription in the front. Merry Christmas to Kristen and Amanda.
My daughters.
Those are Reverend Randy's daughters. This is their book. Just like last week's book was my daughter's book. All right, rainbow fish. A long way out in the deep blue sea, there lived a fish. Not just an ordinary fish, but the most beautiful fish in the entire ocean. His scales were every shade of blue and green and purple, with sparkling silver scales among them. I love this book because there are actually sparkly, shiny scales. Kind of like your fingernails. The other fish were amazed at his beauty. They called him Rainbow Fish. Come on, Rainbow Fish, they would call. Come and play with us. But Rainbow Fish would just glide past, proud and silent, letting his scales do the talking and shimmer. One day, a little blue fish followed after him. Rainbow Fish, he called, wait for me. Please give me one of your shiny scales. They're so wonderful, and you have so many of them. Do you want me to give you one of my special scales? What do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Get away from me, said Rainbow Fish. Shocked, the little blue fish swam away. He was so upset. He told all of his friends what had happened. From then on, nobody would have anything to do with the rainbow fish. They turned away when he swam by. What good were these dazzling, shimmering scales with no one to admire them? Now he was the loneliest fish in the entire ocean. One day he poured out his troubles to the starfish. Really, I am beautiful. Why doesn't anybody like me? Well, I can't answer that for you, said the starfish. But if you go beyond the coral reef to a deep cave, you will find the wise octopus. And maybe she can help you. You're right. The rainbow fish found the cave. It was very dark inside and he couldn't see anything. And then suddenly two eyes caught him in their glare and the octopus heard. I have been waiting for you, said the octopus in a very deep voice. The waves have told me your story, and this is my advice. Give a glittering scale to each of the other fish. You will no longer be the most beautiful fish in the ocean, but you will discover how to be happy.
But I can't do that, said the rainbow fish.
But the octopus had already disappeared into a giant cloud of ink.
Give away my scales, my beautiful, shiny scales?
I could never do that. How could I possibly still be happy without them? Oof.
Suddenly, rainbow fish felt a little light touch of a fin, and that little blue fish was back.
Rainbow fish, please, please don't be angry at me. I just want
Rainbow fish wavered. It was only one, a very small, shimmering scale. He thought, maybe I won't miss just one. Carefully, the rainbow fish pulled out the smallest scale he could find and gave it to the little fish.
Thank you so very much.
The little blue fish bubbled playfully as he tucked that one shiny scale in among all of his other blue scales. A rather peculiar feeling came over Rainbow Fish. For a long time, he watched that little blue fish swim back and forth with that one shiny scale glittering in the water. The little blue fish whizzed through the ocean with his one scale flashing, and it didn't take very long before Rainbow Fish was surrounded by a lot of other fish. Everyone wanted a glittering scale. The rainbow fish shared his scales left and right, and the more he gave away, the more delighted he became. When the water around him was now filled with glimmering scales, he at last felt at home among all the other fish. Finally,
Sadly, the rainbow fish had only one shiny scale left. It was his most prized possessions. He'd given them all away, and he only had one left, and yet he was very happy. "Come on, rainbow fish," the other fish called. "Come and play with us." "All right, here I come," said rainbow fish, and happy as a splash, he swam off to join his new friends. And there he is. I love the cover, the inside papers of this book. Let's see. Picture of rainbow fish. He's got all of his scales, and then when you get to the end of the book, it's the same picture, but he only has one. He's giving them all away.
Except for one.
Thank you for bringing this and letting me read it.
Well, I gotta tell you, I just read this for the kids in Hatfield. I read it. You did it. You did all the theatrics and the stories. One of the things we want to talk about after church is the little blessings that we have that we can share. I gotta tell you, a little blessing, another little blessing. I don't mean rude by saying little.
We have so many.
Another blessing he's going to be sharing this out around this table with us now for an anthem, this meditative. Kind of sink into it. Count all these blessings and let's use them and appreciate them and help us to grow. Anthony? Prayer, and I'd like to begin by just mentioning that we continue to pray
for the persistent and institutional racism here in our country that may be brought to an end. We pray for the 227 million people infected by the COVID-19 virus worldwide. Out of that, 42 million of them are right here in the United States of America, and also for the 688,000 people who have died to date, which I think I heard translated to 1 in 500 Americans has now died from COVID. On my drive to church this morning, the numbers are just so high that sometimes I can't process them, but I think I heard there's 165,000 new cases a day, and that there are 2,000 Americans dying every single day, still 18, 19 months into this COVID pandemic, and those numbers are rising, and they don't need to be, but they are. So we pray for that. We pray that the resurgence of this virus here and worldwide may be brought under control. We give thanks for the vaccines that are available to us, and we pray for those people who have little or no access to them. We pray that the efforts to get them help may only increase. And are there any other prayers, joy, celebrations that you would like to share? We'll go to Zoom in a second, but are there any from here in the building that anybody would like to share? Judy? I don't know if there's a mic or so. I got the fan out, I can't hear a word, I'm sorry, I'm getting old and deaf. We have Lisa.
Lisa to the prayer list.
Thank you, you got a good voice.
Not me.
We're adding Lisa to the prayer list. Are there any other prayers and any joy celebrations? Glorious day. This is the last Sunday of summer. This is my favorite time of the year. I just love it. I give praise to God for that. Any other prayer celebrations?
Any prayers for the
All set. Resume to. So, FCAT, I know this is a delay, but if you at home have any prayers that you'd like to share with us, get them to me, and we will have them in our next service. So even though you're home at a delay, please share your prayer and concern and celebration with us. Got one?
Nope.
Okay. All right. So we also have this yellow sheet, and I think by now we all know the routine. We're just going to be saying the first names just so we don't broadcast that out to the worldwide web and to our FCAT community without these people wanting to have that all known to a wider congregation than this. So we have the entire list of names, but we're just going to say the first names. So we offer our prayers at this time for Alice, Amanda, Art, Betsy, Bill, Bonnie, Bruce, Charlene, Cindy, Denise, Donald, Dwayne, Erica, Evelyn, Jeff, John, Leo, Melissa, Michael, Michelle, Prue and Bart, Steve, Wayne, the victims of violence everywhere in the world, those affected by natural disasters around the globe, and we pray for peace on earth. So in the middle of our public worship, let us just turn inward for just a few moments of silence and say to Jesus the things that we just don't want to share publicly. For just a few moments of silence. Gracious Savior, reveal to us as we are willing to welcome all who are represented by the powerlessness of a child. Grant us a child's excitement and candor to explore your word and how it is meant to inspire the way that we lead our lives. Teach us as you once taught your disciples so that we may not so much aspire to greatness as power over others, but as the greatness revealed in Jesus, whoever wants to be first must be last, and of all, the servant. We recognize and are inspired by your care for everyone, even to the embrace of the helpless child. We turn to you with our prayers, knowing that the way you care for that child is the way you care for all of us, so that we can trust that our prayers will be heard, and that they will be answered as you alone know best. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And let us now be bold enough to share the prayer that Jesus gave us by calling God our Father. So may we now join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. Anthony?
Thank you. gospel is taken from the gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 30 to 37. And they went on from there and passed through Galilee. And Jesus did not want anyone to know of him, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But the disciples did not understand what he was saying, and they were too afraid to ask him. And then they came to Capernaum, and when Jesus was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest among them. Jesus sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then Jesus took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not only me, but the one who sent me." May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be accepted to you, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. A clergy friend of mine enjoys traveling to untraveled places. She actually plans her vacations by going to the local airport website and checking on all the different non-stop flights. She won't stop it. She's got to get there and get home. So she checks for all the non-stop flights anywhere in the world on a particular day when she wants to go. When she finds a place that she has never visited, and I think that list is getting smaller and smaller over the years, and to tell you the truth, one that I don't think a lot of us would ever visit in the first place, she goes and books the flight. She travels to these untraveled places all by herself, to places where I think a woman alone, I would be kind of scared if that was my wife or my daughter or somebody out there. But she goes, and her partner won't even go with her, wants nothing to do with this. But she just loves that excitement. She loves the discovery of finding and discovering new places. Now, COVID obviously curtailed a lot of these kind of things for her, but she still needs that adrenaline rush of doing something new and exciting. So at the end of August, she took a ride in a biplane. And I bet you, maybe you've seen it flying overhead. It's that one with the two wings, and it always reminds me of Snoopy, you know, the Red Baron pilot with the goggles on and all that. And you can see it. I know I've seen it from my yard. It flies over out of Northampton Airport. And for me, that means you're out there with the wind blowing in your face, maybe just some goggles on. And I don't know if I would want to do that, but she needs that adrenaline. So she's up there. She actually told me that she flew over our church and that she waved. And by wave, I don't know if that means she'll look over the side and look down and wave. I wouldn't be able to do that. Or if it actually means that she asked the pilot to wave by, you know, tilting the wings. Either way, that is not something that I would look forward to doing. Then, on top of that, she went whitewater rafting. Just because she can't travel, she decided to go whitewater rafting. I wouldn't be surprised if this woman doesn't even know how to swim. She would just be even more excited if she did that. She also experimented with a ride and a glider. Put me in something up there without an engine, I would be terrified the whole time, but she loves that kind of stuff. And then just a few days ago, this past Thursday, she went on one of these planes that takes off and lands right on the Connecticut River. So one load of excitement was lost for her. She couldn't do all that traveling, so she found another way to get the adrenaline rush of doing something new and exciting. So I'm not that kind of person. The closest thing I do to that is if I go to a restaurant and order something new on the menu that I don't usually get. That's as exciting as I get. But, you know, I really appreciate her enthusiasm. You know, it's not everybody that can do it, but the fact is that when one path to what she wanted was blocked, she went looking for another way. She wanted that adrenaline rush. When she couldn't travel, she did all these other things. She went looking for another way. She didn't settle for the old ways to be the only way. She didn't settle for the old ways to be the only way. So let's keep her example in mind as we think about today's readings. Last Sunday we read the first passion account of Jesus. And he said to his disciples for the first time, he said, "I don't know if you can get this, guys, but I'm going to go to Jerusalem. We're walking that way now. I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to die. And I'm going to come back." Now, this new revelation is so upset Peter, as you may remember from last week, that he takes Jesus aside and he reprimands
Jesus. Peter yells at Jesus saying, you can't say these things. And then we got that famous verse that almost everybody knows, get behind me, Satan. Then between that first passion prediction and the second passion prediction that we just read today, there's that remarkable story of the transfiguration. We're asked in the order, the list of readings that we're supposed to go through week to week, we jump over the transfiguration because we read that almost every year at the beginning of Lent. So we don't read that story, but I think a lot of us know the story of the transfiguration. But just imagine that you're Peter, James, and John, you go up a mountain with Jesus, the carpenter, and then all of a sudden, up on the top of the mountain, Jesus is revealed in all of his heavenly glory. Think of him with Moses and Elijah kind of just floating there, you know, glowing. They said in whiteness that not even a bleach could ever do in human terms. It's just white as white, glowing up there, and you're sitting here trying to figure out what just happened to Jesus the carpenter. And so when you are exposed to that, imagine you come down. Imagine you tell the other disciples about what you just saw. I bet you are just brimming with hope. Look at who we are following. He was floating in the sky. He was with Elijah. He was up there with John the Baptist, Elijah. He was up there with Moses, the giver of the law. And now Jesus is up there, and he has chosen us to be his closest followers. And so if Jesus is that great, well, geez, can you imagine how great we must be? And then amongst the 12, you start getting a little bit more particular. No more is it just imagine how great we must be. Which one of us is the greatest? And doesn't it always get to that point? Oh, we're all great, but somebody's got to be the greatest. So sure, Jesus had said now for the second time, I'm going to be betrayed, I'm going to suffer, I'm going to die, I'm going to return. But that didn't make any sense to the disciples. They had had 1,000 years of expectations of the Messiah just, you know, burned into their consciousness. And it's this idea that the Messiah is powerful, that the Messiah is going to come with all of God's power, and that there will not be any suffering, there will not be any death. The Messiah comes to conquer. The power, glory, that old story, that they had no problem understanding. Even though Jesus had just said for the second time, bluntly, I'm going to suffer, I'm going to die, I'm going to come back. They had no problem understanding power and glory. They could not wrap their heads around that. So on that walk, imagine Jesus a few steps ahead, the disciples in a little group walking behind, arguing amongst themselves, who is the greatest amongst us? Then they arrive in Capernaum. They arrive at maybe Jesus' house. And so when they get into Jesus' house, Jesus had heard little snippets of his conversation along the way. And he says to his disciples, what were you guys talking about that whole walk? Nobody can say a word. Jesus knows that they were talking about who is the greatest. And so he has to try to break through this line, this defense line that they have that will not allow them to hear Jesus. They cannot hear his words. He can speak and flow right over their heads. They just cannot hear what Jesus has to say. They are so locked into the old way that they cannot hear the new way. You know, after the first passion prediction, Jesus countered their reluctance to believe by saying, you know, you're going to have to take up your own cross and follow me. There's going to be suffering involved. That's a heavy charge, but it's also heroic. In Hatfield, one of the ladies at the, when we were offering our prayers of intention, she offered a prayer of thanksgiving that her relative, her nephew, had come back from Afghanistan. He was part of that Fort Bragg group that had gone there in the very last days of Afghanistan to help people get out, and now he was back home. And, you know, that's scary, that's hard work, but it's heroic work. And we hold that up, and we're proud of all of that. And so there is that. And Jesus saw what that did. It led to this conversation about who was the greatest. So Jesus has got to change gears completely. So instead of saying who is the greatest, all this idea of heroics, this idea about floating up into the sky with this glorified Jesus that God is going to honor all of us, instead, Jesus says, you have to be the servant of everyone. There's no heroics in that, being the servant of everyone. Think about that opening African-American hymn. You know, they have nothing. They are owned by other people, and yet they still sing, I want to be a Christian. You know, so there's no heroics in that. There's just that faith, that strong kind of faith. And Jesus says, you've got to be a servant to everyone. And since these disciples are having such a hard time,
hearing Jesus, he has to do something visual. He's got to give them something to look at. So Jesus, imagine Capitol. This is his new hometown. So there's neighbors. Some of these neighbors have come into the house. There's little children. And Jesus takes one of those little children, a boy or a girl, holds that little baby and embraces that little child, holds that child. Now this is a day and an age where children were not men's business. That was women's work, and children were more of a nuisance. You know, you waited until they were grown up. You had children so they could help you work. And that was about it. It wasn't very sentimental. But Jesus takes the child and embraces the child. Then here's this man. Here's this one that they just saw glorified. Here's the one who's giving this message that they can't make any sense out of. And now he just says nothing. He holds a child. And he says, when you welcome even this little child, you welcome me. That's a brand new revelation. They've heard it, now they see it. It's a message of compassion. If you want to know God, you've got to be able to see God in everyone. Even the ones that you would walk past, even the ones you would ignore, even the ones you don't want to know and have to acknowledge, you hold them all. That's the compassion. That's the new revelation of Jesus. And you tell me, do we still hear that, or do we let it go right over our head? This idea that in worshiping God, we have to care for everyone. That's Jesus' new revelation. You know, I think my friend's example is really helpful at this point. When COVID prevented her from traveling, well, she didn't give up and just stay at home and say, oh, this is miserable. She went looking for it in other places. She went looking for it in a new way. The old way wasn't going to be the only. Holding that child in his arms, Jesus has shown us a new way to God. And it's just like the message that Jen shared with that rainbow fish story. You know, giving away, he could have been, you know, made poor in a sense. He found out that he was richer, that he was blessed, that he was happy, because now there were others that he shared with. He could have had all the scales and been alone, or give away all but one, have friends. The rainbow fish was smart enough for a child's book to understand that you want the friends. That's the same message as in the gospel. So in today's reading that Irene shared with us from James, he shared the message, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. Sometimes not enough to wait for God to do everything. Sometimes we have to draw near to God for God to draw near to us. Think about that when we stay in church, and in a sense stay in a worship mode, and think about the future of this congregation. What do you want to do to find a new way to express our faith and our worship of God? We can definitely keep everything that's old, maybe add on to it, maybe add something new. And you know, draw near to God so he can draw near to you. How do we worship God? By showing compassion. You know, we heard Donna talk about the crop walk. You will never see one of those people that you benefit halfway around the world. They will never be able to pay you back. But when you can love the ones who can't do anything for you, when you draw near to them, God draws near to you. And that's Jesus' new revelation. And again, just like the disciples, we go right over our heads unless we try to really pay attention to what Jesus is challenging us to be, a compassionate, loving people that is able to see God in each other. And these are the things we pray on this last summer Sunday, on this ordinary, glorious day that God has given us, and an ordinary, glorious thing that his church, and a glorious, ordinary thing is being the people of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us now turn to our closing hymn, Red Hymnal number 29, Now Thank You All Our God.
Thank you.
if I could, because I really think that what we're going to do right after this is still part of worship, it's still part of the work of the church and the people of God. I would ask that we not extinguish the candles. Leave those candles burning as a sign that the Spirit is still here and needed, so that when we gather for the meeting, we still realize that this is part of the work of the church. And so I just ask please to leave those going burning for another hour as a symbol that we are still at worship when we gather for our meeting. The benediction can serve as the invocation for our meeting, and then maybe Anthony can play his postlude. But no doubt everyone is going to be staying for the meeting. We have guests and stuff here, but even guests are more than welcome to stay. We're democratic and open, and you're more than welcome to stay to participate in the discussion. But we will, at that point, after Anthony's postlude, we'll turn off the cameras, Houston, and we won't broadcast that to the whole world, though. And we'll turn over the microphone to John, who is the church moderator. So at this time, the benediction prayer. Through our time together, let us trust more in Jesus and also in one another. Let us strive to live each day, seeking to be even more devoted to our faith in word and in deed. May the rhythms of prayer and service enrich our lives. May God's gentle spirit fill our days and our souls. Into the protective hands of God, Jesus has placed our lives. We trust in God's providence, believing deeply in our souls that God knows us by name and he loves each and every one of us. Our strength is renewed and our dignity is reaffirmed. Therefore, let us go forth to love and serve the Lord among all whom we will meet this week.